the microphone is actually still working. I haven't just been talking for 1 hour and 17 minutes just to myself.
But talking to you lovely people out there, wherever you may be, Norway, Switzerland, Germany, Brazil, Japan, China. Sorry, that's from Street Fighter. India. I think King 9 here is a call. And unfold now. We maybe can float there. It's pretty close. Pretty close, that one. Do the monsoon, guys. Kind of a good name, the monsoon, I think. Cyclone, tornado. Those names are kind of cool. It's kind of easy to remember, I think. And it sounds a little bit exciting. Kind of like a battle. You're in the storm. Whereas Full Tilt's got those stupid names, you know. Like Tyrannosaurus Rex and the Big Ben. You know, I think if they're going to go with a theme... It should be they should go with a theme. They don't seem to have a theme. I mean, one hand you're naming it after an old clock, and the next minute it's a dinosaur. Like, what are you trying to say here? What's your message? This is, button, kind of loose player, M6.5. 1.5 to 1, we only need 40% equity. He probably jams Jack Queens and stuff like that. I don't think we can fold here to this guy. Can we? Definitely offsuit, you know, is a pretty easy fold. That is how we do it. That is how we roll around here. Equilab. Probably actually jamming with a sort of this sort of stuff, I guess. That stack depth against us. Something like that. And we had ace-3 suited. Yeah, I mean, 43.5 is going to be a call, right? I think, given the pot odds. So. The other thing is, too, like, I just kind of don't like folding to that sort of, like... I just think we kind of look a little bit weak, you know, if we start folding to that sort of jam size, you know. We are on a roll. We are on a roll, people. Don't talk too soon. Touch wood. M7.5, top left. Probably actually just play carefully against the Bronze Star. They've been very tight. And this player I would jam against. And I think jamming from any raise behind is a pretty obvious play with ace-10 at M7.5. So it's important to note that the top right, we can get pretty good stack leverage against really all of the players except, well, he has gone for the 3x, which is interesting. It's not going to deter me from jamming, but, you know, it's just interesting to note. It seemed like he probably didn't want to jam, and that's why he did it, you know, just to look stronger, I guess. But the thing is, it gives us a lot more dead money when it works, so it's kind of a two-edged sword. On the one hand, a newer player might sort of raise bigger with his bigger hands there. 3x might be a bigger hand, but if it's a different way of thinking about it, might be that he's just trying to get a little bit more fold equity. So he's raising bigger and he's still going to be folding a lot. And we get to pick up a bigger pot when he folds. So I think there's probably a little bit of value to eke out bottom left. I'm probably going to check now. He's probably got a jack or, you know, a queen or worse, like, he might actually have tens or nines here with a heart, I guess a lot of the time. He can have the nuts, but it's pretty rare that we're going to run into the nuts because he would probably bet flop and just play it differently at some point. So we probably get a little bit of value from, like, nines with a heart that just... or king 10 with no heart that just happened to hit a straight, I guess. This is that guy that jammed us a bit before, right? Mr. Stetson. I think that's just interesting to keep in mind. I get a bit really small here. This guy's defending pretty loose. We get huge leverage. It's pretty close. It is a pretty close play because... it's a bad board, but we can see that he's defending loose and he has M8, so we get good leverage from the c-bet, and the ICM probably is going to dictate that he's not just going to get crazy on us, if he's aware of ICM at least, you know. And that's important to keep that in mind, that some players might not necessarily have ICM on the mind. But it's a pretty big deal right now. It's actually a really nice table dynamic with the big stack on our right, isn't it? And the stack sizes the way they are. I think it's a really good scenario. Probably going to fold here, I think. It's kind of short and he's opened. We've got a hand that's easily dominated. Doesn't flop that well. And it's 2.5x, I mean, yeah, I think it's fine. I'd probably just raise on the big blind rather than jam, but it's pretty close. I'm a little bit concerned that this big blind is not going to be thinking about ICM. And that can hurt us a little bit. I like the way this big stack's playing. It's another 3-bet there. Good timing. You're really putting some pressure on these guys. Mr. Stetson. It's a nice jam, M10 against a cutoff open. He knows we're open very wide here. And I don't think we can call here. I don't think we really need to call here. I just think it's pretty borderline. What happened here? Big blind defended. His PR is almost one. He's double checked. I think I'm going to bet now, actually. I think he would just bet with any pair. Once we check flop. And so, it's kind of a... Wow. Kind of a protection. Protection bet. Since we're so sure we have the best hand. I guess I'm going to fold here, but this could be a well-timed squeeze. something to definitely watch out for. Wow. I don't really want to commit this hand with the five, so I think I'm going to lay it down, but I mean... That guy's going to have clubs a lot, but he could have like sevens or eights, I guess. That just wants to sort of bet while the board's semi-dry. While he's more likely to have the best hand before any high cards hit. Just getting a little bit tired now. Yeah, I mean, the pay jumps are pretty significant here, right? So 50, 180, 120. Yeah, we can definitely put some pressure on these guys. This guy defends really wide, so it's a bit risky. He might jam a little bit wide too, but... I think I'm going to just check here and just... I think he probably... Wow. Oh, man. I can't believe... I can't believe he hasn't stabbed at any point. It's kind of annoying. I was going to check jam. Check jam. I just thought he might stab at it at some point. Once we check, I thought... His range is pretty wide. If he's got a hand like 6-8 of spades on the flop, I mean, I thought he might just bet small to try and win it. We can eke out a little bit more value. Or maybe get some fold equity if he actually does bet a hand like a 7 or like king 6, although I don't know if he fold that, but it's really annoying the way the hand's played out now that we haven't hit and we've got the showdown with a hand that could have bet to win on the flop or probably the turn, but I don't know if we can call now with queen high, right? Let's see, bet now, jack 9, 6, 9, 7, 8, 10, I might check down with a 10, not possibly as hearts, could be betting queen high as well as a bluff, yeah, it's pretty annoying. Maybe a little bit too tricky on my part there. Just, I mean, I don't know. He just seems like the sort that would just bet if checked too, to be honest. That's what I thought anyway. This is a little bit concerning because Mikurtu has been 3-bet a few times by... Haymaker, and so it feels like he might tighten his range, but at the same time, I think eights is just too strong to do anything else but jam, and he does just snap fold, so he's maybe just going to keep opening. I think A-Maker can actually open pretty light there. He seems to be playing really good, this guy. It's a good spot to raise there with this stack distribution. And I maybe could have three bet. You know, he might just be waking up with hands. We don't know. Don't have enough information, but his style, the way he's playing to me, from what I've seen, just suggests that he's a good player. Bottom left, this is kind of like the situation I mentioned before, where the guy actually might have actually hit the ace and decided to get value by checking. We have a four bet pre, so our betting does kind of look a little bit bluffy. And you notice I bet really big to try to build the pot. Just in case he does have the ace, I don't think he's folding. Very kind of hard to for him to put us on a hand because we're at the top of our range, a hand that strong. 12. This guy's opening pretty loose. Yeah, I'm gonna jam this, I think. This guy's opening pretty wide. Sixes. M's. Yeah, I think I'm gonna jam this. And he just snap folded. This one's going to go in, I guess. He's on the button. Does have a three betting range that we probably do okay against. It does kind of look strong, but that's the sort of hand he can have in his range. And where are the queens around here? The poker gods are back. They were out of the office, so they've just come back from a break, and they have punished us for trying to make a big, deep run in two tournaments at the same time. By giving us some punishment there with 30 players left for what would have been had us up and sitting around sixth in a good position in a soft field. So it's too bad, so sad. Just going to defend here and play it a little bit cautiously. Not so much cautiously, but I think there's too much need to get too out of line here. And this guy has a decent stack size, so he can kind of put a little bit of pressure on us. He can jeopardize us a little bit. Of course, we can pressure him more, but I mean, it's just worth noting that we don't really necessarily want to have a huge clash against him with the other two shorter stacks in, just like he doesn't want to have a big clash against us. I guess I'm gonna check. Didn't seem like too much reason to bet. It's pretty hard to get called by worse. Jack 9, Jack 7, Ace 10 might call, I guess. But even then, I mean, that's pretty thin. He's gotta hope we have just some really random weird hand like Queen 6 suited that called on an up and down and now bluffs, or queen five suited or something I should say. But yeah, seeing the three betting again, and this is good play. He's pressuring the, I wouldn't say medium stack because they're kind of deep, but that's the sort of situation that he wants to be creating, because I mean he can put a lot of pressure on this guy because he doesn't want to bust before these guys. These two here are getting kind of short. Yeah, and a little c-bet takes it down, and he's really getting set up for the win, A-maker, isn't he? Now I come to think of it too, the name kind of rings a bell. And I think we can probably just raise here. But Stetson's going to jam pretty wide. We have a king blocker. He's jammed us so much, actually. I thought he might not. Just because he might think, well, ace is up, so probably going to call soon. But yeah, I think he's probably got like king nine suited or ace two, maybe queen 10. I think he's jamming really wide here, but I just, I mean, we're not calling, but. It's part of the reason why the jam was, I mean, the open on the button there was kind of close, just because he has abused us. He has abused us pretty badly with his jamming. And he's just had that constantly, kind of had that nice stack size to do it with, hasn't he? M5 and M almost 6, right? Yeah, I don't know what I'm thinking about. We can't fold that. Two ball. Yeah, I mean, not with the short stack in there as well. And then he's only he was pretty short anyway, that guy. I mean, that was a pretty easy call, I guess. Bring this in. It's a little bit too weak, the 2-5 suited. Just slightly too weak. It's a little bit of a risk of domination, you know, against the other big stack, and it's just not going to flop enough equity often enough where, you know, I'd rather have a sort of a 10-7 suited. We lose Stetson. Played well, that guy. It was one of those GGs where I mean it when I say good game. He played well. Very strong looking 3x multi-way from small blind. He's only 3-betting a small percentage. We would have flopped top two pair. I dare say it would be good. Very hard for it not to be. This guy's probably got kings or something. I mean, it could be a squeeze, but it's a pretty animalistic squeeze if it is. It's a pretty sick squeeze. See if we can't finish Scar off here if he gets involved here. M4, he's gone with it. King 9, he has flopped the world, and we are drawing dead on the turn. Probably just fold this one against Scar. I mean, he's so short now that he's probably knows that he has to make something good happen. You don't have to be an Einstein to realize that. So he's kind of got a little bit of pressure off him in the sense that he is supposed to be the next to bust because he's so short. So it means that he's not necessarily supposed to play tight. You know, he's supposed to try and make something happen to avoid being the next to bust. So he can. I think 3-bet jam at a reasonable frequency and that sort of thing. It's not like he's very risky where if he makes a mistake and busts, like, damn it, I could have moved up in pay because unless these big stacks collide and most likely it'll be some, you know, big cooler situation. Well, I mean, not necessarily because it's four-handed, but, you know, the way these guys are playing at the moment, it's fairly controlled. If there was a loose fish maniac, maybe it'd be more reason for Scar to consider playing a little bit tighter because there's a good chance someone will bust next. But it hasn't really been looking like that in this instance. Kind of a little bit hungry. I think we might get some good credit when we do Jam A Maker. Because when we 3-bet, I should say. Because we haven't really done that much against him. So I think we're going to get some credit. Tough spot, top left. Problem is his calling commits our stack and we're over M20. I don't want to get an ace 9 and have this guy have us crushed. So yeah, it was really close, I think. I mean, this guy's stealing pretty high frequencies, so there's an argument for jamming since we're well ahead of this guy's jam range on the button against a cutoff opener who's been stealing at high frequency, and he's got the stack size to jam where he wants to be jamming. So, but it's a little bit too risky, I think. Just an awkward stack size to work with. Playing a little bit slightly on the tighter side. And I think that's more just to do with game flow and the ICM. Haymaker's doing a fair bit of attacking. And whilst we do want to play for the win, we don't necessarily need to go out of our way to clash with the other big stack. Until Scar busts. I think once Scar busts, I'm going to step up the aggression a lot. Hopefully it'll take A Maker and the other guy by surprise, because I've been, I would say, yeah, like I was just saying, on the tighter side the last, well, most of the final table, actually, really. Other than the very start, I think we opened up a little bit, but we'll go with a 4-bet here, actually. This guy raises. He's been 3-betting quite a lot. It's not that playable ace-5. You know, I don't mind sacrificing some EV by raising. And we've been pretty tight. Eight, nine, nine, two. Got ourselves into a really tough spot here, didn't we? He can have quads occasionally. He might even have ace 10 and just call flop. But what I'm most worried about is he has a hand like sevens that didn't quite want to get in pre because we've been tight, but wanted to call. And he might play it this way, I think. But I don't think I'm folding to a bet on the river. Yeah, he has nines, so just because there's clubs there, I mean, he could have called with clubs on the flop. I'm surprised he didn't go for a little bit of value there. But, you know, it would have been really tempting if he bet kind of small to shove on him and turn our hand into a bluff. And that was what was kind of going through my mind. But I don't know if we can expect him to fold. I mean, it would look like we had, I guess, queens up or a jackpot. I wonder what he would do if we took that line with nines. Puts him in a pretty tough spot, but yeah, his hand's a little bit face up, and he might know that we know that, and be able to drill down in the multi-level thinking scheme of things and make a good call. Too bad that ace, that three bet didn't work, and we happened to just run into a hand that strong. Just gonna call here, obviously. And I think if we had a little bit of something going on, I might float this flop, but we do kind of want to be floating some of the time in that instance, just because he's betting pretty small. And easy for his open to show an immediate, his c-bet to show just a very big immediate profit. So I think in terms of just, yeah, having a range that we want to defend with in position, some an overcard, backdoor club, or backdoor straights and things like that, what we'd be looking for. Because obviously we're not going to flop a pair often enough to be defending at the right frequency if we're only calling when we flop pairs. Because that's only going to be roughly 30% of the time. His c-bet only needs to work when he bets that small, probably 30% of the time, 35. So we really should be defending 70, calling it 70% of the time to stop it from showing an immediate profit. And to be able to defend that wide, I mean, you want to start adding in a lot of, and this is balance I'm talking about. And I know I was saying earlier, well, in previously, in another part about balance not being that important in MTTs, well, and sometimes it does players more harm than good, but just from a mathematical point of view, from, you know, it's one time when it's, I think it's something that's good to understand is that. Especially when it's short-handed and he's got a big stack and he's playing aggressively, we need to do something to prevent him from just running over us. We can't be waiting for the nuts, so we're gonna have to, you know, select some hands where we do make a play or you know, call in position, and otherwise we're just gonna get run over. And he's, all his bets are just so profitable that it puts us in a tough spot. That's the only problem when, you know, we haven't really been three betting much is now when we do, he can fold pretty happily and know that we have likely had a good hand. It would have been nice to get in another one or two three bets as a semi bluff before we actually woke up with a hand like Ace King, like the Ace Five, you know, that one. And then if we get in another three bet with a whatever, you know, a king eight suited, and then once the suspicion level has been raised of our opponents, well, like, hey, ace is up, started three betting a bit, he might be light here. More chance they call with a dominated hand, we dominate, or they four bet us, and more chance we can get more value with a hand like that. But I think our range, when they assign us a range most of the time now, it's still going to be kind of well, interesting hand, still a little bit on the nitty side. That's kind of good for us because obviously Rapdog goes down. Rob Dag, I should say. Rob Dag. I think I'm gonna. I don't want to raise too big. It could be a little bit awkward post. On boards, well, you know, that's the thing about raising this side, this size is It's kind of a bad card, I guess. This is a little bit of an annoying spot. Did a little bit of a weird donk bet down the bottom. Just because we had the gutsa with the over. Just think about this for a minute. He played pretty cautiously before with the nines. Would he do that again? He might. He might play pretty cautiously. He knows we're being a little bit tight, but he did see his 3-bet ace 5. And he knows scars are going to be short. Just thinking if he has much of a floating range. Ace jack, ace 10. I think a lot of the time here he's got the small pair again, which is very unfortunate. Just kind of annoying the way that hand went down. But the 3-bet preflop, you notice the sizing was quite small. And the reason I did that is just to give us that situation where we can escape pretty comfortably post. If I had made like a huge 3-bet and he called and then c-bet, we get to the turn in that instance where, we don't even have maybe as many chips left in our stack as we do in the pot. And obviously I'm talking about SPR. And if the SPR is a lot under one, it just makes it very difficult to fold in certain situations. Maybe not necessarily in that spot against this player the way he's played, but in general, you want to design your 3-bets. So they can be profitable, of course, on their own merits, whether it's initial profit or post-flop profit against your opponent. But a lot of the times, the post-flop profit, when it comes to post-flop, the how profitable the play is going to depend on the SPR you've created. And in that instance there, we want to have an SPR where we can make a threatening c-bet, but we don't want an SPR where we bet and then he jams and we maybe have to call or maybe make a huge mistake by folding because the pot odds are huge. And normally under SPR 2, under 2.5, 2.5 and under is where that starts to become specifically significant and awkward. Around 2.5, under 3 I should say, but 2.5-ish is when it's really hard. If the SPR is really low, of course, on the flop, that's fine. I mean, if in that instance there, if the SPR on the flop is one, I would just shove the flop. But the other option is if you can't get the SPR very low and make the hand easy to play post, you can keep the SPR a little bit bigger, which is what I tried to do by three betting very small. I tried to keep the SPR a little bit bigger. And that then gives us a little bit more flexibility in terms of we can c-bet and fold to a raise, or we can c-bet, and then if we get a good turn card barrel, or we can, decide to give up or whatever line we want to take. It just gives us a little bit of more maneuverability rather than just being in a spot where we c-bet and feel forced to commit, or maybe just get in a really tough spot where maybe we have, our overcard's alive and we have six outs, which is 24% from the flop to the river, and that means we're getting 3-1 and we probably have to call and maybe sometimes we're ahead and just in that sort of really unclear, tough spot. So on that note, guys, I will end this part and just gonna pause the video for a minute, take the break and be right back. See you soon. This has been Aces Up for PokerNerve.com. Final table, let's try and win this one.